Hi there, I'm Aphrodite Rose Starfire, and today I want to talk about the structure of your mind.
We know the dream's the same every night. Why do I have to go?
Please continue.
Hi there. I'm Aphrodite Rose Starfire, and today I want to talk about the structure of your mind.
Children look like burnt paper. Black. Don't worry. And then the blast wave hits them. They fly apart like leaves.
Dreams, cataclysm, the end of the world are very common.
It's not a dream anymore, it's real. I know the day that happens.
I'm sure it feels very real to you.
On August 29th, 1997, it's gonna feel pretty fucking real to you too. Anybody not wearing 2 million sunblock is gonna have a real bad day, get it? God, you think you're safe and alive? You're already dead, everybody. Him, you, you're dead already. This whole place, everything you see is gone. You're the one living in a fucking dream, some of it, cause I knew it happened.
First of all, thank you and welcome to all my new and old subscribers. If you've been with me for a while, you noticed that I've started editing my videos and been pretty creative as I've gotten new capabilities on my iPhone 8 and got a little snazzy for you today. So I wanted to talk about the structure of our minds and dreams and so I quickly figured out growing up that I don't think like other people and I don't dream like other people. I have way out there, live different lives during my dreams, even since a child. And when I would tell my parents about it, or when I would tell other people about it, I quickly realized to shut up because they didn't know what I was talking about, or it was kind of freaking them out how much detail and how much I remember of my dreams. And a lot of my dreams are pretty grotesque and like disturbing. I mean, it runs the gamut of everything. And I also had a lot of deja vu growing up where I'd feel dizzy and feel like I've lived that moment. Like as a child, I remember on the playground, I'd have moments of deja vu at a certain spot on the playground. And I would feel this like heaviness, this gravity, and I would have this sense, this feeling like, and I'd have this like mantra in my head, like, I've been here before. Who am I? Who are you? Why are you in this body? You've done this before, you've been this before, like you know what's gonna happen. And sensation progressed and got stronger as I grew up and as I started using cannabis, that really opened up that feeling. I don't get the deja vu as much. But anyways, when I was a ninth grade in high school, my English teacher, Dr. Mr. Gibbs, told us that, he's like, you know when you can't think of something and it's on the tip of your tongue and you can't get it. He's like, don't worry about that. When that happens, there's like a little elf, a little Keebler elf. And he even gave the imagery of like it has wings on his sneakers, like Nike, like a little Hermes, you know, like a little god with the wings on his shoes. And when you ask yourself a question, like, you know, like, what's the capital of Kansas? I don't know what it is. I was on the tip of my tongue. There's like a little elf that is sent out into your brain and goes through all the files. And he's searching. And Mr. Gibbs said, so don't worry about it. Once you send that elf or that little guy out there, he's gonna find the answer. And you can forget about it. It might pop up in your head in a second. It might take a minute. It might take an hour. It might take a day. But that elf will come back with the answer and it will pop in your head all of a sudden. And when I heard that when I was 14 years old, I knew that. It was like a memory. And I knew it was really important and it clicked with me. And that was like, I was like, yeah, that's how my brain works. And it's kind of, I've had almost a photographic memory, and as I got older, I realized that my brain is more structured like a mall, like a 1980s shopping mall. And this was figured out through multiple recurring dreams that I have every night. I have multiple dreams every night, but especially older in my age, I'm constantly running down corridors and going in and out of doorways. And if you follow my channel, I've described this many times before. With my dreams, it switches in and out of a shopping mall / hospital where I'm working as like a doctor making rounds / a cruise ship hotel. But for the most part, it's like a shopping mall. And like an indoor outdoor, and I'm usually running through it and going in and out of doorways, and I know secret ways to go. And it's only been recently that I've seen this represented in different movies and media, but it's also like I would describe it as the back hallways of a mall. And I would describe this to people as in the movie Terminator 2 when they are at the mall and they go behind the arcade. And it's kind of like these bare walls with doors. And you open each door and that's like a room in your brain of like where you organize things.
You know John Connor?
No.
Oh. Hey, do you know this guy?
Nah, I don't know.
John.
Not now.
Hey, man, there's this cop scoping for you. Check it out. Spill it, man. Just go.
Yeah.
I think I saw that kid room.
Hey.
Hey!
Get down.
Also, it morphs into Sarah Connor running through the mental hospital. I've also been that person, but it's usually I'm a doctor running. I'm usually running from my boss. Like I'm trying to get out of the hospital to go home.
Get in the office. On the floor, face down. Not you. Open the door. On the floor. Hold it open. Face the wall.
Had that dream in a long time. Right now it's a mall, which is a standard for me. And this goes into like union archetypes. For most people, it's like a house, like the house they grew up in, their childhood home. But it's usually a familiar structure, and you organize your memories and different aspects of your life in different rooms. The first time I saw this, like, I was like, that's my head, was in this Netflix series called Lock and Key. And it's about this family who inherits their ancestral home, and the home's filled with these keys, and the keys insert into the nape of their neck, in their, basically their cerebellum. The key goes in there, kind of Matrix style, and different keys do different things. One key turns you into a ghost, like your body drops, and then your spirit goes out and you can float around. But if anybody discovers you, it looks like you're dead. So one of the keys is you put it in the back of your head and you walk out of your body and you can go into your brain. You can go into your mind, and anybody that's like with you can go into your mind with you. So the little boy, Bodhi, he goes into his head, and it's like a toy chest, and they go in, and it's kind of like this fun house. If you've ever been to like Circus Circus in Las Vegas arcade, it's like that, like where all these crazy things going on all over the place, kids jumping around, and that's what his brain's like. when the teenage girl does it, it's a 1980s mall, and I was like, that's my head. That's my head. And it's not as colorful. It's like kind of like how it is when they step in the beginning with that 80s Formica floor tile. Mine is very plain, like the Terminator 2 Galleria.
Don't wander, don't touch anything, don't take anything.
Don't take anything. What are you gonna take? Can you actually take stuff? Of course it's a mall. Oh, that's cool though. That's a really cool looking mall. Oh wow, that's crazy. Crazy ass mall. Was it MC Escher? Right? Fitchies are in there? Oh no. Candy.
But I just find that interesting. But it just proves that we're very structured in code, and our bodies are taking on code from outside influences, such as viruses that hijack our cells to produce proteins. And if we have enough of this virus, we build up proteins that aren't natural to our body. And that can make us susceptible to maybe our thoughts being controlled, or not being able to perceive our surroundings the way it is in reality. So I think it's important to kind of know how your brain is structured. And I would say that to know would be referencing your dreams, usually where you're running or being chased. And any place where there's like hallways and doors. Now, where you can get sophisticated is how things are organized. And this goes into the next movie that I've been very interested in lately called Dr. Sleep. And this is the sequel to The Shining. And it basically describes the situation we're dealing with today about old beings parasiting off of young spirits, i.e. adrenochrome, like vampiric, but it also has to do with addiction. And seeing that your addictions, even though it might seem that it's not hurting anybody, it always is hurting somebody. No matter the scale of it, of what you're addicted to, whether it be drugs, alcohol, sex, blood, fear, but anyways, the head of the tribe called the True Knot, who are the old kind of vampires who live off the steam, which is the essence of psychic children that they abduct via using different types of glamours. They call it pushing, which is pushing their thoughts into an individual and making that individual do what they want them to do. But the head of the True Knot is called Rose the Hat, and of course it's Rose. And in Terminator 2, Arnold Schwarzenegger is carrying his gun in a, you know, long stem roses. And so Dr. Sleep, I highly recommend. I knew that there were some scenes where they torture children, and it's pretty obvious when that scene happens, and I just fast forward through it. And the rest of the movie is relatively, like, you can get through it. There's not, like, any surprise, nasty scenes. Other than the one where they harvest the steam from the baseball boy. But, Rose astrally travels to find the highly psychic girl Abra, and Rose is extremely beautiful, extremely attractive, confident woman that, you know, is ancient, and...
Well, hi there. Do you want one? Oh, no, sweetie.
Wow. Well, hi there. You said it didn't hurt.
The scene of her flying through the air is how I fly in my dreams with my arms by my side. And I don't like fly like this. I like fly with my arms by my side. And it's like effortless. Because if I do try to flap, because I do try to flap sometimes, it's harder. But It's usually cold when I'm flying.
I'm not
Rose, the hat goes through the mind of Abra, and its filing cabinets, like my high school teacher had originally described. And then Abra goes into Rose's mind, and it's like a cathedral with Dewey Decimal card catalogs. Like a cathedral library.
Keep sleeping, princess. Spend your whole lives making little boxes, little memories. Oh, you think they make you so rich. You should see mine, kiddo. Oh, my mind's a cathedral. Well, hi there.
You said you'd come back. And you did. Good.
Get back! Get back! Oh, you're just a fucking child!
Little boxes, little boxes. You put things in little boxes. But I found it interesting that she also, in a way, put her own thoughts and memories in little boxes. And I think here is a place where you can set traps and think outside the box and think of a more open landscape of how you organize things. Maybe like an ocean, or with like different worlds in the ocean, or like a garden with different, I mean, that's still kind of boxy, but it gets away from in a building, which is pretty Masonic. I was also thinking of a map, of how you can structure your thoughts in a map with different countries and different worlds representing. And that's kind of how my mall is, in a way. Because I do have indoor-outdoor areas and levels. And there is a landscape around my structure. It's surrounded by water. A water with marshy land. So I invite you to do some investigation into your mind and how you structure things. And again, I suggest starting with your dreams. If you're not remembering any of your dreams, something's wrong, I think, there. And if you're not remembering your dreams, I suggest you start trying and looking into how. I mean, it's pretty easy. You just start with writing something down when you wake up in the middle of the night. You just jot a word down or just anything. You don't have to write an essay. And then you go back to sleep. Or you can maybe like have your phone and record like a, you can just record a video, just, you know, videoing the wall, but talk and say what you remember. And then when you listen to it the next day, it probably will sound like gobbledygook, but it will help you remember. But you have to start trying remembering your dreams. And that will help with the amnesia. But the simple fact that my structure of how I organize my head is represented outside of me in media shows that it's an artificial construct, and I'm building with pieces that were given to me from a toolbox, I believe. So, we are very powerful, and we don't have to think it within boundaries anymore. Okay. I love you all.